Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar, IAS Academy. Displayed are the list of news articles selected for today's analysis and their page numbers in Chennai, Delhi, Bengaluru and Thiruvananthapuram editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping of the news articles are provided in the description box, and for the benefit of mobile phone viewers, the timestamping is also provided in the comment section. Now let us move on to the analysis of first news article. This news article is authored by the present Vice President of India and the ex-officio chairman of Rajya Sabha. This editorial article talks with respect to the abrogation or removal of Article 370 of Indian Constitution. The word abrogation has been used in this news article to mean the removal of Article 370 as it was earlier present as the temporary provisions with respect to the state of Jammu and Kashmir. The Vice President states that this Article 370 was only a temporary and a transitional arrangement in the Constitution of India that was given to the state of Jammu and Kashmir. So this means the article was not included in Indian Constitution with the objective of making it as a permanent provision. So this was not the objective. That means the provision was only of temporary nature. We know that during independence, that is during 15th August 1947, the state of Jammu and Kashmir was not acceded to the Indian territory. The Jammu and Kashmir was acceded to India by the then ruler of Jammu and Kashmir, Hari Singh. This was done through an instrument of accession. This instrument of accession was signed by Maharaja Hari Singh on October 26, 1947. The author mentions that even during the time of accession of Jammu and Kashmir, there was no Article 370 in the Indian Constitution, even though the Constitution was being drafted by the Constituent Assembly at that period of time. So when was this provision included in the Indian Constitution? During the period of drafting. So the author says that this was included at the demand of Sheikh Abdullah, who was a member of the Constituent Assembly that drafted the Constitution, and this was included in October 1949 only. And the provision became operative only in the year 1952. So we know that Sheikh Abdullah had been the top leader of the government of Jammu and Kashmir between March 1948 to August 1953. Then the author notes that the inclusion of Article 370 in Indian Constitution was also objected by the then Law Minister of India, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. Dr. Ambedkar has mentioned that the inclusion of Article 370 goes against the interests of the Indian nation. Then according to the Vice President, the article did not bring the people of Jammu and Kashmir closer to the people of rest of India. So this is because of the provisions in Article 370 and the special status accorded to the state of Jammu and Kashmir. So this is because according to Article 370, Jammu and Kashmir can have a separate constitution and it can have its own flag. Indian Parliament had jurisdiction only with respect to the matters of defense, external affairs and communication and other matters as mentioned in the instrument of accession. And if at all, Indian Parliament has to extend its legislation to the state's jurisdiction, it has to be with the concurrence of the government of Jammu and Kashmir. And any law passed by Indian Parliament can be adopted only according to the state legislative assembly of the particular state. And before the institutionalization of state legislature, this power was vested or empowered with the Constituent Assembly of the particular state. The same Article 370 also brought Article 35 capital A by way of presidential constitutional order. This Article 35 capital A talked about the permanent residence of Jammu and Kashmir, and it also talked about various special status that are to be given to the state of Jammu and Kashmir. And we know that a non-permanent resident cannot buy an immovable property in Jammu and Kashmir. See, because of all these reasons, the author is saying that Article 370 did not bring the people of Jammu and Kashmir closer to the people from the rest of India. So since Indian laws cannot be extended, and therefore a set of important central laws could not be implemented in Jammu and Kashmir for the welfare of the people as demanded by the central government. And there was also no better scrutiny of government schemes that are made for the people of Jammu and Kashmir. And because of the provisions that a non-resident cannot buy any immovable property, the state of Jammu and Kashmir actually lacked investments and therefore lacked growth, and also there were not enough jobs for the youths. Thus, the Article 370 has become almost an impediment or a hurdle to the development of Jammu and Kashmir. So these are the opinions as mentioned by the author in the news article. So all these situations was exploited by the separatists who wanted Jammu and Kashmir to be separated from India. And these separatists actually worked for dividing the people of Kashmir from the people in the rest of India. In the editorial article, the vice president diplomatically mentions that a neighboring country has used Article 370 to spread terrorism. So this is an implicit reference to Pakistan, because Pakistan claims the entire territory of Jammu and Kashmir as its own land, and by using Article 370, it wanted no development for the people in Jammu and Kashmir, and also it did not want Indian government's control over the territory of Jammu and Kashmir. So this situation was favorable for them to provoke Indian youth in Jammu and Kashmir to involve in insurgency, separatism and also in terrorism. Based on all these things, the author says that the Article 370 is a dysfunctional provision, meaning that a provision that did not work for the betterment of Jammu and Kashmir, rather it worked against it. And the author also mentions that in the present scenario, in the current context, this Article 370 has no relevance. We have discussed in detail the issues with respect to Article 370 and Article 35 capital A and other issues with respect to then state of Jammu and Kashmir on August 7 and also on August 6, along with the discussion of various news articles such as the new facts on the ground for Kashmir, an open editorial on August 7, and also about Lok Sabha endorsing the center's decisions on Kashmir, another news article discussed on August 7, and also with respect to Jammu and Kashmir losing its special status and also bifurcation with respect to Jammu and Kashmir on August 6. So for the developments with respect to abrogation or repeal of the earlier provisions under Article 370, and also with respect to Article 35 capital A, and also with respect to the bifurcation, we request you to go to the analysis on August 6 and August 7. The author also mentions that the demand to remove Article 370 has been there for a long time. So therefore, the demand is actually not a new one. And the discussions to remove Article 370 has started way back in 1960s. Because there was a discussion on this matter in Parliament in 1964. See, there was a discussion on a bill moved by a private member who sought to abrogate Article 370, and the author mentions that there was a near unanimous support to carry out the removal. So there was not a complete support, but there was almost a complete support for the removal of the temporary provision of Article 370. Way back in 1960s. The news article also mentions that there was also a long-standing demand to remove this section by many sections of people in the state of Jammu and Kashmir, including Ladakh. And therefore, this is the right time that this transitory provision has to go, and Jammu and Kashmir should be fully integrated with the rest of India. And therefore, the legislative bills to deal with the situation was passed by 2/3 of majority in the Rajya Sabha and 4/5 of majority in Lok Sabha, and that was after an elaborate discussion, according to the news article. The vice president mentions that the abrogation of Article 370 is actually a step in the right direction that safeguards the unity and integrity of India. And we know that it also extends the central laws to Jammu and Kashmir. And as a result, a total of 106 central laws will now be extended to the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. Earlier, the women of Jammu and Kashmir, if they marry a non-resident, then they could not transfer property to their children nor their husband, and those immovable property in the Jammu and Kashmir. But now, with the removal of Article 35 capital A because of the abrogation of Article 370, the decades-old discrimination against the women of Jammu and Kashmir has ended or has been eliminated. And because of the special status removal and because of the abrogation of Article 370, now Jammu and Kashmir has been fully integrated with the rest of India. So now immovable property in Jammu and Kashmir can be bought by any non-resident also, and this means there will be definitely flow of greater investments And with the greater investments, there will be possibility to generate employment opportunities for the local youth. And this means the local youth will focus on development and career rather than being a tool for the separatists and the terrorist factions to exploit. Now that the state of Jammu and Kashmir has been made into a union territory of Jammu and Kashmir and also into a union territory of Ladakh. So this means there will be a better administrative control of center over the territory of Jammu and Kashmir. And therefore, it will also enable greater scrutiny of implementation of the central government schemes. Thus, the author concludes that the abrogation of Article 370 therefore opens up new vistas for the overall development of the region of Jammu and Kashmir that was earlier neglected because of the presence of Article 370, and the decision of the government to abrogate Article 370 will definitely going to improve the quality of life of people belonging to the regions of Jammu, Kashmir and Ladakh. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this news article. Now let us move on to next article. This news article is about India's no first use policy on nuclear weapons. See, India has conducted nuclear tests in Pokhran in May 1998. After this test, a draft nuclear doctrine was prepared by the National Security Advisory Board, and this National Security Advisory Board was chaired at that time by Mr. Subramaniam. Several meetings were conducted by the Cabinet Committee on Security. After this, the Cabinet Committee on Security met several times, and on January 4, 2003, the Government of India has issued a statement on India's nuclear doctrine and also the operationalization of its nuclear deterrent. Now, when we say deterrent here, it means the policy of India that discourages the use of nuclear weapons by someone. And India has expressed its policy with respect to nuclear weapons by a press release by the Ministry of External Affairs titled as the Cabinet Committee on Security Reviewing Operationalization of India's Nuclear Doctrine. Now, first is that India will build and maintain a credible minimum deterrent. And next is that India will follow a no first use posture. That is, India will use nuclear weapons only in retaliation against a nuclear attack on Indian territory or a nuclear attack on Indian forces, be it anywhere. Next is that there will be nuclear retaliation if someone first strikes India. And this retaliation will be massive, and it is designed to put unacceptable damage to the other country that has struck India first. The retaliatory attacks will be authorized only by the civilian political leadership through a nuclear command authority. And this nuclear command authority consists of two councils, one a political council, two an executive council. The political council is chaired by the prime minister. It is the only body that can authorize the use of nuclear weapons. The executive council will be chaired by the national security advisor. This council will be giving inputs for taking decisions by the nuclear command authority, and it also executes the directives given to it by the political council. So within the council, the political council is the supreme. And then the nuclear weapons of India will not be used against any non-nuclear weapon state. And it is also decided that India will retain the option of retaliating with nuclear weapons in the event of a major attack with biological weapons or even chemical weapons by the another country. In addition to the no first use policy, India will also show its continued commitment with respect to achieving a nuclear weapon free world. So these are the main important points from the government statement. Now let us see the news article. See, the Defense Minister of India has put a message in the social media platform Twitter that the future of India's no first use policy on nuclear weapons depends on the circumstances. This was tweeted after visiting the nuclear test site in Pokhran in Rajasthan. This message has raised questions as if whether there is any change in the nuclear doctrine adopted by India earlier. The minister has tweeted that Pokhran is the area that witnessed former Prime Minister Atalji's firm resolve to make India a nuclear power, and yet remained firmly committed to the doctrine of no first use. India has strictly adhered to this doctrine. What happens in the future depends on the circumstances. That is, Pokhran has showed that the former Prime Minister of India, Atal Bihari Vajpayee, had a strong vision to make India as a nuclear power, while at the same time, India also was strongly committed to no first-use nuclear doctrine, which we have strictly adhered so far. But according to the Defence Minister, this policy depends on circumstances with respect to the future. And he also stated that India has attained the status of a responsible nuclear nation, and this status has become a matter of national pride for every citizen of India. So while we have nuclear weapons, India has no first use policy, India is a responsible nuclear nation, and India is also committed to achieving a goal of nuclear weapons free world. But these are the comments that have been made by the India's defense minister days after Indian government has removed the special status of Jammu and Kashmir, and also the abrogation of Article 370, and also the bifurcation of the state of Jammu and Kashmir into two union territories. Union territory of Jammu and Kashmir with legislature, union territory of Ladakh without legislature. Now the statement of the defense minister can be interpreted in a way that even if India feels that an adversary may attack India with a nuclear weapon or without a nuclear weapon, there are chances that India will use nuclear weapon first to prevent any attack by an adversary. And another purpose of using nuclear weapon first will be to incapacitate the adversary. That is, to destroy the ability of the adversary or the enemy to attack India using their military of nuclear arsenals. So these are the some of the concerns that raised, even though that is the reason why the news article says the no first use policy is not rigid. That is, it is flexible. It can change according to the circumstances. If some country is planning to attack India, India may use nuclear weapons first to prevent such attack. So these are some of the information with respect to the analysis of this news article. Now let us move on to next article. This news article is about the recent announcement by the Prime Minister of India regarding the formation of a post called as Chief of Defence Staff. The Prime Minister has said that there will be a Chief of Defence Staff, and after formation of this post, all the three forces, Army, Navy and Air Forces, they will get effective leadership at the top level. And this Chief of Defence Staff system is a very important and compelling task to reform the strategic pace of Hindustan in the world. And the Prime Minister has also stated, according to Press Information Bureau, that any Hindustani can be proud of Indian military. So these are some of the words addressed by the Prime Minister on the 73rd Independence Day, according to the Press Information Bureau of the Government of India. Now, the author of this editorial article is the Chairman of National Security Advisory Board of India, and he is telling that the appointment of Chief of Defence Staff will have a far-reaching impact on the management of defence forces in our country. And it is expected that the formation of this post will create more efficiency in defense planning and in civil-military relations. When we say civil here, we actually mean those persons who are not serving in the forces but are involved in decision-making of the processes related to defense. For example, the Minister of Defense and other ministers in Defense Ministry. When we say military, these are the persons who are in the leadership level of the three forces, say Army, Navy and Air Force. After the Kargil conflict, or according to the author, Kargil War in 1999, there came an issue, and this issue is nothing but the efficient management of higher defense organization. That is, efficient management of decision-making processes in the higher ladders of three forces. And a committee was formed, and this committee was called as Kargil Review Committee. This committee was headed by Mr. K. Subramaniam. This committee was asked to examine the anticipation and also the detection of Pakistani intrusions in Kargil and also the military response given. And the committee highlighted various strategic issues with respect to the structure of India's national security and also the poor coordination among the forces and also the technological inadequacies in the military. In addition to this committee, the then government also constituted a group of ministers. The purpose was to review the national security management. And this group of ministers have given recommendations covering intelligence, internal security, border management, and also on Defense. And these recommendations finally resulted in appointing a national security advisor. And there was also new measures taken to strengthen intelligence coordination mechanisms and also to upgrade the technological capacity of security agencies and also to sharpen the institutional responses to traditional and emerging internal security challenges. But on one particular front, the implementation of recommendations was disappointing to the author, and that is with respect to the defense management. Here the author cites certain issues with the defense management. One is that the armed forces are not formally involved in decision making on defense planning and strategy. And this perception among the top leadership of the armed forces is reinforced by treating the service headquarters as like attached offices with respect to decision making in defense planning and in strategy. When we say service headquarters, we mean the headquarters of three services and related institutions with respect to Army, Navy and Air Force of the Indian Armed Forces. So this structure of lack of formal involvement of armed forces in decision making has led to some non-transparent decision making processes right from administrative requirements till the acquisition of weapons. So this is one aspect with respect to the defense management front. Then the author talks about certain reasons that necessitates the creation of the post called as Chief of Defense Staff. Now, this is because in the present day scenario, the concept of military conflicts are not just with respect to land, air or sea, but it goes even beyond them into the domains of space, cyber, electronic and even information. So when we say there has to be an effective defense preparedness, it requires a jointness of the Indian Army, Indian Navy and Indian Air Force. And these three forces has to incorporate the domains of space, cyber, electronic and information into their war fighting strategies. And the changing phase of military conflicts also require prioritization of weapons requirement of the forces and also optimization of resource allocations that are based on clearly defined national defense strategy. Then the author mentions about two recommendations given by the group of ministers. One is with respect to achieving better efficiency by integrating the armed forces headquarters into the Ministry of Defense. And the next one is to create a post or to appoint a chief of defense staff who could promote an integrated approach to inter-service prioritization and also resource allocation. And the chief of defense staff will also pool some available common structures to avoid unnecessary redundancies. It means that by merging the different structures for the entire armed forces, the unnecessary procedures and the delay can be avoided. The chief of defense staff will also be administering tri-service institutions. Now these are institutions that will be having men from Indian Army, Navy and Air Forces. For example, Andaman and Nicobar Command. The CDS will also be taking care of the recently set up tri-service command for cyberspace, space and even the special operations. Say for example, in order to tackle the conflicts in cyberspace, it's about having a team which includes members from all the three forces. So these are important because of the changing nature of modern day conflicts that extends even to cyberspace and space areas. And then the CDS will be providing coordinated military advice to the defense minister. That means he will get the individual advice from the chief of concerned armed forces. Then he will give coordinated military advice to the defense minister. And he will also be developing a national defense strategy based on national security strategy. And this strategy should be factoring in of traditional and non-traditional threats. And it has to be inclusive of internal security requirements, at the same time also considering the external strategic objectives. When we say traditional threats, these are threats through land, air and sea. Non-traditional threats are, you know, cyber attack, attack in the space, attacking Indian satellites, say for example. So these are some of the non-traditional threats. And these strategies will also be developed based on the collaboration with the civilian defense leadership of the Ministry of Defense. That is the Minister of Defense. So therefore, there will be Minister of Defense and there will be Chief of Defense Staff who gets the individual perspectives from the chiefs of different armed forces. So therefore, the author states that the creation of such a post would help to improve the civil-military relations. So the civilian defense leadership is the elected representative Ministry of Defense, and the civil-military relationship means the relationship between armed forces and the elected representatives of the government in the Ministry of Defense, who are not members of the armed forces. There were certain issues with respect to the creation of such a post. These are some of the reasons why the Office of Chief of Defense Staff was not yet established till the recent announcement of the Prime Minister. Even now, it is not established, but there is only an announcement that soon we will be having a Chief of Defense Staff. The author says that there was opposition from the sections of armed forces, from bureaucracy, and also from political parties. And this is because of the perception or an understanding that the Chief of Defense Staff will override or may undermine the authority of the chiefs of three forces, Army, Navy, and Air Forces. And the another concern was that an all-powerful Chief of Defense Staff may distort or disturb the civil-military balance in our democracy. That is, the Chief of Defense Staff may disturb or weaken the democracy, and it may lead to military taking over the administration, as happened in certain countries such as Pakistan and Myanmar. But the author says that these are misperceptions. We can see many countries, you know, including the United States, having such an institution of Chief of Defense Staff or its equivalent with varying degrees of operational control over the armed forces. But this has not diluted the civilian control over the governance. That is the control over the governance by the elected representatives, or in other words, by the people rather than the military. Having such a position has actually increased the participation of military in the defense decision making along with civilian bureaucracy. Therefore, it enhances the coherence and transparency of policies. Earlier, we saw that the present structure of lack of formal engagement of forces in decision making leads to opaqueness. The CDS will also be having other important functions like developing multi-domain military strategies and strengthening cooperation among the three services, and also enabling the proper planning. So this would help in achieving jointness or oneness in training or infrastructure and in various exercises. The author says that only after achieving this jointness in training, exercises and infrastructure, then only there can be a discussion about feasibility of regional commands in the specific context of India's geography and the nature of its internal and external threats. The CDS is also expected to play effective role in defense acquisition processes and also preventing redundancy of capacities among the services. That is nothing but preventing the inefficiency among the services and also enabling the better use of available financial resources. The drag end of the news article, the author also talks about indigenization. The statement given by the chairman of National Security Advisory Board is that it is a shame that India is still among the top arms importers, and it is not fitting to an aspiring great power to depend on other countries for weapon systems or weapon components and even ammunitions. Therefore, the author suggests that every further arms acquisition must be structured to strengthen our indigenous technological capacities so as to aid in achieving self-reliance in defense. And among other benefits, the author concludes by saying that this reform of appointing a Chief of Defense Staff will minimize the frictions in civil-military relations and will bring greater efficiency, greater transparency and accountability into the decision-making on defense matters. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this news article. Now let us move on to next article. This news article talks about the National Essential Diagnostics List. See, a diagnostic procedure or a diagnostic test is an examination to identify a person's health condition or the disease or a illness. So when we say National Essential Diagnostics List, now this means an essential list of diagnostic tests that have to be carried out by the healthcare providers in our country. Now, this list has been released by the Indian Council of Medical Research. See, for providing good quality health services, the availability of high quality diagnostics in healthcare system is necessary. Therefore, the Indian Council of Medical Research have developed this National Essential Diagnostic List that consists of general lab tests that are required for routine patient care. This list consists of diagnostic tests for different communicable diseases and also non-communicable diseases. When we say communicable diseases, these are diseases that can transfer from one individual to another individual. These diseases are also called as contagious diseases. They are generally caused by some microorganisms like bacteria, viruses and other pathogens. Some example of communicable diseases could be dengue, tuberculosis, AIDS. And non-communicable diseases are those diseases that does not spread from one person to another. For this, we can give lifestyle diseases as example, such as diabetes, you know, hypertension, etc. This list is actually based on the first edition of Essential Diagnostics List that was released by World Health Organization in May 2018. And India is the first country in the world to launch the National Essential Diagnostics List. And the WHO's Essential Diagnostics List just acts as a reference point for the development of a national list. And we should note that India's list has been customized and prepared as per India's healthcare requirements at the national level, suiting to the conditions of India. India also has a national list of essential medicines. See, it is a list that consists of the medicines that are commonly used. They have to be available at affordable costs with proper quality. But the same importance was not given to diagnostics. Therefore, it is said that the introduction of National Essential Diagnostics List will complement the National List of Essential Medicines with respect to the healthcare delivery mechanism. The National Essential Diagnostics List has been developed for all levels of healthcare, say from village level to the district level. It is said that this list will provide guidance to the appropriate government for deciding the kind of diagnostics test that different healthcare facilities in, you know, villages and remote areas can use. And it is said that it is also complement the Prime Minister Jan Arogya Yojana. In July 2015, the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare has launched the Free Diagnostic Service Initiative. And this has been done under the aegis of National Health Mission. Under this initiative, the National Health Mission is supporting all states to provide essential diagnostics at their public health facilities free of cost. And it is said that this list will complement all initiatives of Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, even the National Rural Health Mission that was launched in 2005 to strengthen the rural public health system. Now let's see some advantages that India would achieve by implementing this list. One is that it will enable improved healthcare delivery through evidence-based care. When we are able to diagnose the illness and accordingly provide the treatment based on the diagnosis, we call it as evidence-based care. Here, accurate diagnosis will be made by providing the diagnostics list for various purposes. So we say that quality diagnostics and quality healthcare system can be ensured with the help of National Essential Diagnostics List. Next, it would improve the patient outcomes. That is, the health conditions of the patients would improve. When we are able to improve the patient outcomes, the out-of-pocket expenditure will automatically come down. It is nothing but the money spent by the individuals to healthcare providers for receiving the service. If the illness is properly diagnosed and if it is treated in the first instance, then the out-of-pocket expenditure will automatically come down. Then the healthcare providers can assess the trend of diseases and also the disease burden and outbreak identification. Now, when we say outbreak identification, that is to identify where and when a particular disease has started to spread. So by analyzing these data, the healthcare providers can take necessary precautionary measures to prevent an outbreak in the next season. And this essential diagnostics list is said to enable the standardization of diagnostic services. And it will also help in the promotion of R&D of new, appropriate and effective diagnostic devices also. So this is said to reduce the cost burden of providing healthcare for the healthcare providing ecosystems. The list is also set to address antimicrobial resistance crisis. When we say antimicrobial resistance, it means the resistance offered by a microorganism to an antimicrobial medicine. Say microorganisms cause us a disease, so treat the person, we give an antimicrobial medicine, but gradually the microorganisms may have developed resistance to the medicine. So this is known as antimicrobial resistance. Now with the help of National Essential Diagnostics List, we can properly diagnose the diseases and provide appropriate medicines. So unnecessarily developed antimicrobial resistance can be curtailed. See, normally for bacterial infections, antibiotics are provided. Imagine a situation where a patient having viral infection been given with antibiotics. So with the help of diagnostics list, such instances and situations can be prevented. This National Essential Diagnostics List is one of the initiatives of India to achieve Sustainable Development Goal 3.8. See, it sets a target for 2030, that is to achieve universal health coverage. This includes financial risk protection, access to quality essential healthcare services, and also access to safe, effective, quality and affordable essential medicines and vaccines for all. Improving access to diagnostic tests is a key component to achieve universal health coverage in India. And how it can be also a part of financial risk reduction or financial risk protection. We saw a reduction in out-of-pocket expenditure as one of the advantages with respect to having such a list that protects individual from financial burden. When we say financial risk protection, mostly it deals with insurance coverage. Now, there are some key challenges with respect to the implementation of this list of essential diagnostics. One is that adoption of this list by all the states and to uniform or make harmonize this list with the local standard diagnostic protocols and treatment guidelines. And then there will be various diagnostic procedure that will require certain diagnostic infrastructure or processes or adequate human resources will be required. Now the next challenge is therefore to provide such necessary infrastructure, processes and human resources for the implementation of these tests that are mentioned in the National Essential Diagnostics List. Then the next challenge is to ensuring the quality of tests that are conducted. Then the next challenge is that healthcare providers should carefully make use of these tests mentioned in the list so as to decide on treatment protocols. Now, even though there may be infrastructure, there are chances that it might not be properly utilized. For properly implementing this list, there are also some other requirements according to Indian Council of Medical Research. See, there should be an independent body or an independent committee to look into the minimum acceptable specifications or standards for the diagnostic equipments to carry out the tests mentioned in this list. Then there has to be research studies to study about cost effectiveness of different diagnostic technologies and also diagnostic equipment. To ensure the quality of tests, there has to be quality management systems and they have to be implemented at various levels. To study the trends and also to take required policy decisions, there has to be a laboratory information management system that has to be launched so that the data can be integrated at the national level after the collection of data. So this Indian Council of Medical Research is actually located in New Delhi. It is the supreme body or the apex body for formulating, preparing, coordinating and also promoting the biomedical research in our country. And its mandate is to conduct, coordinate and implement medical research for the benefit of society. Indian Council of Medical Research. So it conducts medical research for the benefit of the society. And another mandate is to translate the medical innovations into products or medical processes and also to introduce them in the public health system. And the release of National Essential Diagnostics List is one example of carrying out the mandate. And this Council of Medical Research is funded through Department of Health Research of Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. Now, these are some of the information with respect to the analysis of this news article. Now let us move on to next article. This news article is about a social boycott in assisting a man with respect to performing the last rites for his wife. The issue is said to have happened among the people belonging to Santhal tribes in the Mayurbhanj district of Odisha. And the body of the woman was not cremated for 3 days after the death, and therefore the local police have recovered the woman's body. And the reason for not cremating is because of refusal among the community members to participate in the last rites. This is because the villagers belonging to the Santhal tribe has asked the husband of the dead woman to pay a society penalty. So only after he paying some penalty that they will be helping him in performing the last rites. If you see the penalty, it includes a goat, 3 chickens, 15 kilogram of rice and 2 pots of country liquor. But the husband was a daily wager. He expressed his inability to pay the penalty, but the community was demanding over the penalty to be paid. Therefore, they didn't help him. 2 practices are mentioned here. One, that the husband has married the woman without giving a gift to the woman's family. And the tradition here is to gift a cow or a bullock. Usually, we hear stories of women's family giving dowry to men's family. But here the story is a bit different. The groom's family has to gift a cow or a bullock to the bride's family at the time of marriage. So one reason for a penalty is because he did not give the gift to the wife's family. The another reason is that the husband's father married outside the clan some years ago. So for these 2 reasons, he was asked to pay the society penalty so that the men in the community may help the husband in performing the last rites. So this is the issue. Now let's see some information with respect to the persons belonging to the Santhal tribes. These persons belonging to Santhal tribes are mentioned in the list of scheduled tribes in 5 states. They are Bihar, Jharkhand, Odisha, Tripura and West Bengal. In the state of Jharkhand, they are also called as Santhals. In other states, they are called as Santhal. Note that they are not classified under particularly vulnerable tribal group list in any of these states. And it is said that the word Santhal is derived from 2 words, Santa and Ala. Santa means calm and peaceful, Ala means man. So these are the men who belong to a community of people living calm and peaceful life. That's the literal understanding of the word. In the past, these persons were leading a nomadic life, meaning they move from one place to another. But it is found that gradually they came to settle down in the Chota Nagpur plateau. And towards the end of 18th century, it is said that they migrated to Santhal Parganas of present day Jharkhand. And then they also settled in nearby states such as Odisha. In the state of Odisha, they are majorly located in Mayurbhanj, Balasore and Kyonjar districts of Odisha. It is said that they speak Santhali language and they have their own script called as Olchiki. It is said that the script was invented by Raghunath Murmu. Their main occupation is agriculture. They also work as industrial laborers and also in mines and quarries. And it is said that persons of this Santhal tribe are polytheists. That is, they worship many gods. Poly means many. It is said that they practice autonomous tribal religion of their own kind. And within the state of Odisha, their population is around some 9 lakhs, close to 9 lakhs, according to 2011 census. Now let's see some of the festivals and rituals that these persons from Santhal tribes follow. So they are Eroksim, Hariharsim, Iriguldisim, Magasim, Jantar, Saharaj and Baha. These are some of the festivals and rituals that are associated with the men and women of Santhal tribes. Persons belonging to Santhal tribes are important in Indian history. We saw that Santhals once led a nomadic life and finally settled near the plains of Rajmahal Hills in the present-day Jharkhand, and they started to practice agriculture. But they were continuously oppressed by the zamindars and moneylenders, and they charged high rates of interest. And when they were not able to pay their debt, their lands were taken away by these moneylenders and zamindars. And the British government also took sides with the moneylenders and the zamindars, or the zamindars and moneylenders took sides with the British government. So this compelled the people belonging to Santhal tribes to rebel against the zamindars and the moneylenders, and also against the British colonialism. They rose up armed with axes, bows and arrows, and they temporarily swept away the British rule from their area. So this happened in 1855-56, and they united under 2 brothers named as Sidhu and Kanhu. and thus they rebelled against the British. So this rebellion we call as Santhal rebellion, or in other words we also call them as Santhal uprising. The British ultimately suppressed the Santhal uprising and they created an area between Bagalpur in the present day Bihar and Rajmahal Hills in the present day Jharkhand, and this area created for the persons belonging to Santhal tribes is called as Santhal Pargana. The British actually thought that by creating a new territory for them, they can impose some special laws and thus they can pacify the fury of the people belonging to Santhal tribes. So these are some of the information with respect to the analysis of this news article. Now let us move on to next article. This news article is about the expression of interest given by New Space India Limited for the private partnership in making the polar satellite launch vehicles. The news article mentions that the NSIL has launched a formal search for industrial consortia, that is the association of companies that can regularly manufacture and deliver the entire polar satellite launch vehicles. It is said that initially it will outsource some 5 PSLVs, and we can see the target of producing 12 PSLVs per annum every year by associating with the Indian industry, and this information can be taken from the expression of interest. So as a first step, they are looking for completion of 5 PSLVs through selected companies or consortia, and after completing this target, then NSIL is aiming to enhance the scope of the contract to 12 PSLVs every year. Now the expression of interest is actually conveying a meaning that a particular company is interested in having a collaboration or a deal with potential companies. Earlier in 2018, the ISRO chairman has actually urged Indian industry to relieve the ISRO from the manufacturing burden. And he also added that ISRO has to do some around 59 launches by the year 2021, and it has to go at the rate of 2 PSLV launches every month. If everything goes well, ISRO will hand over the production of PSLVs to private industries and also go to public industries as well. And this will help ISRO to focus more on its core job of space research and development. About 85% of the sanctioned money of around 6,000 crore for 30 PSLVs is expected to go to participating industries. And this money is allocated for a period of 2019 to 2024. At present, ISRO sources separate rocket parts from different vendors, and it assembles and integrates the components and carries out testing by itself. So this is with respect to launch vehicle. In case of satellites, a group of industries are already helping the Indian Space Research Organization. PSLVs are Indian rockets that can lift light payloads to low Earth orbits. It is a four-stage rocket that places Indian remote sensing satellites and small satellites of foreign customers. It is designed mainly to deliver the Earth observation or remote sensing satellites to sun-synchronous circular polar orbits of around 600 to 900 kilometer altitude. And as said already, it's a four-stage launch vehicle where we can see solid rocket motors in the first and third stage and liquid rocket engines in the second and fourth stages. The news article also talks about ISRO successfully launching PSLV C-46, which carried RISAT-2B satellite. This satellite is called as Radar Imaging Satellite. This is the third radar imaging satellite that is launched by ISRO. The first satellite was called as RISAT-2 and this was launched in 2009. And the second satellite was called as RISAT-1. Was launched in the year 2012. After 2012, it is only in 2019, ISRO has launched another RISAT. It is told by ISRO that a series of RISATs are to be launched in this year and in the coming years as well. And one special feature with respect to RISAT-2B is that the satellite will be helpful in boosting India's surveillance capabilities, particularly during monsoon season, even though the sky will be overcast with clouds. The reason is that it is using microwave radiation and therefore it is not dependent on the visible light. The speciality is that microwaves have longer wavelength and therefore it will not be influenced by atmospheric scattering, and they can easily pass through cloud cover and they can image the ground during day and night even in the presence of cloud cover. So in the case of optical remote sensing satellites, these observations are not possible because they are dependent on visible light. So these are some of the information with respect to the analysis of this news article. Now let's see a few questions in the practice questions discussion session. Now this question is with respect to National Essential Diagnostics List. They have given two statements and are asking which of the above statements are correct. Now first statement, it consists of general laboratory tests that are required for routine patient care and for diagnosis of a wide array of both communicable and non-communicable diseases. See, this statement is correct. So it consists of essential lists of diagnostic tests that have to be carried out by the health providers. The second statement, it has been developed and launched in India by the Council of Scientific and Industrial Research. Now this statement is incorrect because it was developed and recently released in India by the Indian Council of Medical Research. Earlier in December 2018, the Indian Council of Medical Research has released the draft of National Essential Diagnostic List for comments and feedbacks, but recently they have finalized it and have uploaded in their website. So the correct answer for this question is option A, because only the first statement is correct. Now this question is with respect to persons belonging to Santhal tribe. They have given two statements and are asking which of the above statements are correct. First statement, they are the people belonging to the scheduled tribes who live only in the state of Odisha. Now this statement is wrong because during analysis we saw that persons belonging to Santhal tribe are also living in the state of Bihar, Jharkhand, Tripura and West Bengal. And in all these states they have also been notified as scheduled tribes in the list of scheduled tribes. Other than Jharkhand, they are called as Santhals, and in Jharkhand they are called as Santhals. Now the second statement, they are listed as particularly vulnerable tribal group. Now this statement is not correct because they are not classified under PVTG category in any of these states. So the correct answer for this question is option D, because both the statements are wrong. Now this question is with respect to New Space India Limited. They have given three statements and are asking which of the above statements are correct. The first statement, the New Space India Limited is the commercial arm of DRDO, Defense Research and Development Organization. Now this statement is incorrect. This is because the New Space India Limited is a commercial arm of ISRO under the Department of Space. So it was set up as a fully owned central public sector enterprise on 6th March of 2019. Now the purpose is to commercially exploit the R&D work of ISRO. And it also carries out some commercial work for other constituent units of Department of Space. It will perform the role of small satellite technology transfer to industries, and it will also manufacture small satellite launch vehicle in collaboration with private sector, and it will also produce PSLV launch vehicles through Indian industry. It will also produce and market space-based products and services. It will also market spin-off technologies and products and services both in India and abroad. So these are the objectives of New Space India Limited. Now let's come to the second statement. The objective is to spearhead commercialization of space products, including production of launch vehicles, transfer of technologies, and marketing of space products. So these are the functions carried out by NSIL, and the second statement is correct. Now the third statement, Antrix Corporation Limited is the first commercial arm of ISRO. Now this statement is correct. It is also a fully owned Government of India company under the administrative control of Department of Space. It was established in September 1992. So the third statement is also correct. So therefore we find statement 2 and statement 3 are correct, and therefore the correct answer for this question is option C, 2 and 3 only. Now this question is a mains question in GS paper 3. The Prime Minister of India in his Independence Day speech has announced that India will soon have a Chief of Defence Staff. The post of CDS was suggested after the 1999 Kargil War. Why was it not implemented till date, and what are the advantages if CDS is appointed? After the Kargil conflict in 1999, a Kargil review committee was set up, and this committee actually recommended for the formation of the post of Chief of Defence Staff. And this was also reinforced by the suggestions given by the group of ministers tasked by the then government to review the national security management. So the recommendations of Kargil Review Committee with respect to the formation of this post was not implemented because of some concerns. And these are concerns such as undermining the authority of the chiefs of three armed forces. And there was concerns that there could be friction between the chiefs of three armed forces if one among them is appointed. That is, only their voice is heard. And there was also concern with respect to that it may lead to friction between civil and military. That is, it can disturb the civil-military balance in our democracy. That is, it may lead to military occupying the reins of power by usurping the civilian government. These could be some of the reasons why there was delay in the implementing the recommendations. But as stated by the Prime Minister of India, the formation of this post will lead to creation of effective leadership at the top level for all the three forces. Now, one is that creation of this post will lead to a single point military advisor to the government with respect to coordinating long-term planning or procurements or training or even the logistics of three services, that is Indian Army, Navy and Air Force. And then his opinion will be definitely included in any acquisition with respect to defense. So this will make, in a way, formalization of making the voices heard of all the three forces with respect to acquisition process. And the presence of a CDS will also reduce unnecessary delay with respect to decision making, because rather than consulting the chief of three forces, the leadership may now consult only chief of defense staff, who will be getting the individual perspectives of the three forces by himself. And creation of this post will also help to achieve jointness among the three forces in training, infrastructure and defense exercises. And the CDS will also be developing multi-domain military strategies, and he will also strengthen the cooperation between three armed forces. So these are some of the advantages with respect to the creation of the post of Chief of Defense Staff that you can highlight for the answer in this particular question. With this, we come to the end of today's The Hindu News Analysis. If you like the video, click the like button, share, comment and subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates and content on civil service exam preparation.